kalyane niratam karunamayam namami chinmayam devam sadgurum brahma vidvaram sachidananda rupaya vishvotpatyadi hetave tapatraya vinashaya shri krishnaya vayam namaha. Hariom. Salutations to all. So the question Parikshit Raja had asked Shukadev ji was, how should one practice concentration and what is the object as though that has been approved by the scriptures for this practice? And most importantly, what is the objective of that concentration is to remove the impurity of the mind. So concentration here is meant for that. What are the impurities of the mind? The six impurities and then wandering of the mind. And both these, why should we remove? So that the ignorance of the self goes. Till mala and vikshepa is there, ignorance doesn't go. So now the object, see, one, we are using the word object, but it is not an object. It is the subject on whom we are meditating. The Vishwarup here also is of Bhagwan. One is calling it as an object only because the mind holds on to something as different from itself, so it calls it as an object and it thinks it is a subject. But the meditation that is actually practiced is where the object-subject division goes. That is the objective of that meditation. It is not that the mind must retain its identity and get certain concentration powers, which is what generally people think. Here, when Vishwarup Darshan is given, the Virat Rup is there of the Lord, the objective of this meditation is to dissolve the I, small I, in the vastness of the Supreme Being. So the subject has to go. The feeling that I am a jiva, that jiva bhav has to go. So the object which is being used for meditation is actually the subject only. The true subject, the true I, is the object of meditation, which will help to dissolve the subject. If subject goes, object goes, there is only pure awareness. That is the purpose of this dhyana. So now let us see Shukadevji's reply. Shri Shuka Uvacha. Jita sano jita shvaso.
Jita sano jita shvaso.
Jita sango jitendriyaha.
Jita sango jitendriyaha.
Sthule bhagavato rupe.
Sthule bhagavato rupe.
Manasandhara yedhiya.
Manasandhara yedhiya.
So it says jita sano. First requirement for dhyan is jita asana. Jita asana means to be able to sit in a posture without movement. Body movement should not happen because we are trying to attain stillness, silence. The body keeps moving, attention cannot be withdrawn away from the externalities, away from body, and withdrawn within. That will not happen because again and again the mind will come back to the body. And that is the reason why whatever we want to meditate upon also should be memorized. Whichever mantra we take or shloka we take or any stuti we take, that must get memorized. So memory will play a role in dhyan. Because otherwise again we will open the book, again we will see full attention back outside. So jitasana means the ability to withdraw the attention from the body actually, by keeping the body still. Now don't say I choose shavasana for this. You have to sit and meditate. You cannot sleep and meditate. Now, why can't we do horizontal meditation? Because the mind is not used to it. When we lie flat, the mind is conditioned to sleep only. It will not work. So, simple Sukhasan is the best. If one is able to sit in Padmasan, no problem. But don't think that if you cannot sit in Padmasan, then you will not realize. Simple principle is head, neck, spine should be straight. You know, Gurudev used to tell us when he took Balvihar class or some children will be there in front of him, he would always tell, sit like an exclamation mark, don't sit like a question mark. Because so many, even today, so many will sit like that, question mark. We have to tell ourselves again and again, sit erect, push the shoulder back. So, Jitasana means the ability to sit, at least for those few moments. No movements, Jitasana. You know, in Yoga Shastra, to come to this Jitasana, you have to practice 10 rules, Yama and Niyam. 5 rules of Yama, 5 rules of Niyam, then will come Asana. Because if I don't practice those 10, Asana will not come. Asana Siddhi it is called. There it means many things. It means that to hold the body in a particular posture for long time. That's not only for meditation. But for many other things, when they practice, one has to hold whichever posture it may be, Vrikshasana or Matsyasana or any such asana. So, Yam and Niyam has to be practiced, 5 Yamas, 5 Niyamas. That will include Satyam, Ahimsa, Brahmacharya, Asteya, Aparigraha, Shaucha, Swadhyaya, Ishwar, Pranidhan, all those. So, it's not only about willpower and telling the body don't move. Those 10 niyamas will discipline our mind also, that the body can sit still without being restless. So, Jitasana. Then, Jitashvasa. Breathing has to become rhythmic. If one breathes in a particular ratio, fine. If one doesn't breathe in a particular ratio, just simple, slow, deep breathing, but in a rhythm. What happens many times to us is that this breath is not in our control. That's why cold, cough, these are terrible enemies of meditation. Because breathing cannot happen properly, then mind will not have enough prana shakti. An intense focus requires more prana shakti. Typically, if one is able to breathe through both the nostrils, then that is the best. At any given point in time, one side is active for us. In Yoga Shastra, they will say Surya Nadi, Chandra Nadi. So, one should be able to open up both and meditate. Jita Shvasa. There are simple pranayams meant for that. One can open up both and then breathe in simple rhythm. So, Jitasano, Jita Shvaso. Now, coming to the mind, Jita Sangaha. No attachment. Why? Because wherever the mind is attached, there only it will go. Why is the mind attached to something or someone? Because it finds happiness there. So then one wants to go there. So even if I am meditating on the Lord, if my attachment is to something else, it will go there only. Kala Ghoda festival is happening. I am meditating on Lord Shiva, but the mind is going to Kala Ghoda. What is happening there? What are the stalls there? What a nice food available there? My friend already went. Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya. That's going on.
There is a home also, big home over there.
I see. So, in different ways, the mind can think about it. So, then Sangha, attachment has to be overcome. How to overcome this attachment? Devotion is the best method. If I have love for the object of meditation, there is no other method to focus better than love. Everything else we have to use willpower, again it will go back, again pull it back, then use all that. But if devotion is there for Bhagwan, gratitude is there in the heart, I love the Lord whom I am meditating on, then mind will focus on that. So that is Jita Sango. Then Jitendriya. Senses must also be in control. It's interesting here that Jita Sangha is given before Jitendriya. Because in one way it is good. Shama will come first, Dhamma will come next. Shama is mind control, Dhamma is sense control. So control of the senses means what? Not just physical senses. All of us know that physical senses are in the body. These are called the golakas. The indriya is the capability. Seeing, hearing, tasting, smelling, touching. The 10 indriyas, they will crave. When we close the eye, see, the eye is not doing anything. Eye is closed only. But this mind, subtle body of ours, that mind will have some, that indriya which is there, not to see, that indriya will push us. Somebody will say, I am feeling very claustrophobic because I close the eyes. So I cannot close for a long time. I have to open and see what is happening. Same way, ears, tongue, if you meditate for a long time, then one will feel like drinking some water or get up, walk, something. The senses will crave because they are not trained enough to remain quiet. They are trained to be extrovert. And they feel that that is their field, natural field is out. How to keep that senses all in that control? So sense control can happen when I divinize the senses properly. Sense control can happen in both ways. One is if I withdraw properly, I have that much vairagya that the sense doesn't run out only. It knows that it is all worthless. In the Gita, this 5th chapter, there one nice line comes there. Adyantavanta kaunteya nateshu ramate buddhaha. The wise people know that the sense objects, when they contact the sense organs, the joy that is produced is very, very temporary. Adyantavanta. They will begin, they will end. And they are dukkha yonaya evate. They are cause for sorrow only. For this much pleasure, so much effort they will, energy they will just consume. And it will end also. So wise people, nateshu ramate buddha, wise people don't engage in that. Now that is vairagya. So much vairagya is there, so the mind doesn't go out. The other option is divinize all the senses. Do everything dedicated to Bhagavan only. So the thought of the Lord while enjoying through the senses becomes so much more powerful that when I sit to think about the Lord, the senses get subdued automatically. They don't want to see, hear, taste, smell, touch. And if at all they are still like that, then whatever I am using, it is offered to Bhagavan. So Agarbatti is there and flowers are there and then some Naivedya is there and the form of the Lord is there. All that I am going through, training the senses to connect with Bhagavan. Then for a few minutes, see that same Lord who is outside in the mind inside. Increase the duration slowly, slowly like that. Then that Jitendriya will happen. But also Jitendriya, one important part is in the daily life, I also must live in sense control. It's not that 20 minutes of meditation that I have to control the senses. In the daily life, if sense control is not there, I'm eating away to glory, whatever I feel like. Where sense control is there? So eating anything, speaking anything, seeing anything, hearing anything, any input I'm just taking just without restraint, without discrimination, then senses cannot be controlled. So sense control actually forms the foundation. Meditation cannot happen, and that beautiful example you will see when we go to the Kurma avatar, tortoise. Bhagavan takes the avatar of a Kurma and he goes below the ocean and supports the mountain. Because the churning, when they start, immediately that mountain collapses. That is symbolic of this. Without sense control, we will start walking spiritual path, the whole pursuit will just flop. So Bhagavan becomes Kurma and he goes down. So jitendriya. So in the daytime, what are my attachments at the sensory level? I have to work out those. Vrata, tapas, upvas, all those are meant for getting us this jitendriya. Now this is preparation before and during the meditation. Now what to do? Sthule Bhagavato Rupe. One should meditate on the gross form of the Lord. Mana Sandharaye Dhiya. Focus the mind using the buddhi. On the gross form. On the gross form means what? The physical form of the Lord. Sthule Bhagavato Rupe. Mana Sandharaye Dhiya. With the buddhi, know the glory of Bhagwan. With the mind, love the Lord. These two are important aspects about meditation. Bhav comes when we have bhakti, and the value that Bhagwan is the most glorious, that comes when we have jnan, which is what the Lord says in the 12th chapter of the Gita. Mayeva mana adhatsva mai buddhim niveshaya. Nivasishyasi mayeva ata urdhvam na samshayaha. You engage your mind in me, engage your buddhi in me, and you will attain me, there is no doubt about it. So that has to be done. So when we sit for meditation, these four are the external preparations before we start contemplating. When we sit there, then we visualize the form, then invoke the bhav and invoke the knowledge that I am meditating on the Supreme Lord of the whole universe. It will never become mechanical. If I do this, invoke the bhav that I love the Lord, then invoke jnana that the Lord is not just one form. Here definitely it is not one form, it is the Virat Roop. But it will come after this also, that if I cannot focus on the Virat Roop, then focus on the Chaturbhuj Roop or Dvibhuj Roop, one single form. So that is Mana Sandharaye Dhiya. Visheshastasya Dehoyam Stavishtascha Staviyasam Yatredam Drishyate Vishvam Bhutam Bhavyam Bhavachasat. So now that form has been described, that this is the cosmic form, the universal form, in which we see the whole universe in its past, present and future. So that Virat Roop is what Shukadevji is telling Parikshit Raja first. Akhanda Kashe Sharirasmin Saptavarana Samyute Vairaja Purusho Yosav Bhagavan Dharanashrayaha. So he says, Akhanda Kashe Sharire Asmin. So Bhagavan has this body which is of seven sheets. This cosmic body is of seven sheets. Jiva has pancha kosha. Bhagavan here is described as sapta avarana sanyute, sapta kosha. What are these seven? So they have given in the commentary there. The seven are water, fire, air, ether. Ego, Mahatattva and Prakriti. So Maya, then Mahat, then the Ahankar, then space, air, fire and water.
No earth there.
There is no earth in this.
And Swamiji, you said Akhanda Koshe, na it is Anda Koshe.
Sorry, Anda Koshe, my mistake. Anda Koshe it is. Ishvara also is the entity. You see, the individuality of the totality. There's a total ego, it is called, no? That. Sorry? You are asking something?
It's in the form, whenever it's in the form.
No, it is not this one form. So this is the total. So the Vishwa Roop, so Virat is an entity, na? Like we have in our identity, the waking state ego is called waker, which is Vishwa. Then dream state is Taijasa. And then the deep sleep ego is called Prajna. Same way, using the upadhi of Maya, that Brahman becomes Virat, Hiranyagarbha, Ishvara. So identified with all the gross bodies, that entity is called Virat. Identified with all subtle bodies, it is Hiranyagarbha. Identified with all the causal bodies, it is Ishvara.
So in Virat, the causal and the subtle are included?
Huh? Included. Yeah. So that's where it is, that the ego is this. Here the ego and Mahatattva and then the Prakriti. That's how it becomes seven. Physical earth is not included. Mahatattva is that unmanifest. The Mahatattva here is the Hiranyagarbha. Mahatattva here is the Hiranyagarbha, the principle of cosmic intelligence, and then Prakriti is the cause, the primordial cause, power of Maya, Bhagwan's power. Mahatattva is that. Total intelligence is called Mahatattva. Avyakta, Mahat, those are same. So this form is the Virat Roop, that is the object of concentration. Vairaja Purusho Yo Asau Bhagavan Dharana Shrayaha. This is the form one should meditate on. So what is that form now? Constituents of that form were explained, these are the seven. But apart from that, now the whole form, this whole universe now will be explained as a form. Now you may ask, why form is required for that? See, suppose we say Bhagwan is all this. Can we meditate on all this just like that? But if you say Bhagwan is all this, where the sun and the moon are his eyes, and then the, you know, then one form is created. Mind finds it more easier to meditate on a form, whether it is Virat or whether it is a individual. If you say Bhagwan is all this, what comes to the mind will be building, picture, you know, sorry, trees, plants, birds, animals, just individually. The bhav that this is Bhagwan doesn't come only.
Even the bhav that it's a being.
It's a being, correct.
Sentiency
doesn't come. So the form is necessary in that way. For bhav to come, form is inevitable. That's why there is no sense in just fighting this form. That it will go by itself, but I'm saying fighting the form means people have so much of ghrina towards form. They think that those who are form worshippers are some lowly creatures who are primitive in their thinking, and we are very modern in our outlook. We don't believe in form. And very proudly they say, we don't go to temples and all. No, we don't go to all temples. We don't believe in any one form of God. Okay, do you have Vairagya? No. Do you want moksha? Definitely not. Then, simply just repeating that, you know, form. And they will believe in their form. That is the best part. My form is real, but Bhagavan's form is not real. It is like the pot saying that I am real, mud is not real. So form one is simply having that dvesha for form. Nothing it is. Here is also Virat Roop. That is one form. Or you take one particular form of Bhagavan. And wherever they have removed form in history, the human being has brought back form. So why to unnecessarily waste time in all that? Just take a form which is dearest to one, and if one feels that I am not suited for the form, okay, then take sound and see whether bhav comes or not. Try doing Omkar Upasana. Sit and do Omkar Upasana, and if the bhav of Bhagwan is there in that, then only the mind will focus. Otherwise, after 2 minutes, it is gone. wandering will just start. Why? Because I am not able to connect to sound as Bhagwan. Sound does not invoke that much of bhav in me, ki this is infinite Lord only. Though it is, Sagun Nirakar is Bhagwan, is Omkar, is a substratum of the whole universe. But how does a human being's bhav connect to that? It doesn't connect only. Few people who have vairagya, they can do that. So this Sagun Nirakar and Nirgun Nirakar, that requires high degree of vairagya. And in both of them, they have Ishwara bhav. Please don't forget that. People want to reject the form because they want to reject Ishwara, but they still want to realize consciousness. So who is that consciousness? Is that not same Ishwara? Then how are you rejecting Ishwara? So we want to use sound symbol only to attain some concentration of mind and to appear non-religious. So if we think deeply, actually it is not possible. How to do that without Ishwara bhav? How will my mind surrender? This ahankar will not go. How will I realize the truth? That will not happen. And hence form important. Now let us see what is the form of this Virat Roop of Bhagavan. Patalametasya hi padamoolam.
Patalametasya hi padamoolam.
Patanti parshnir prapade rasatalam.
Patanti parshnir prapade rasatalam.
Mahatalam vishvasrajotha gulfau.
Mahatalam vishvasrajotha gulfau.
Talatalam vai purushasya jhanghe.
Talatalam vai purushasya jhanghe.
Dvejanuni sutalam vishvamurtehe.
Dvejanuni sutalam vishvamurtehe.
Urudvayam vitalam chatalam cha.
Urudvayam vitalam chatalam cha.
Mahitalam tad. Mahitalam tad jaghanam mahipate.
Mahitalam tad jaghanam mahipate.
Nabhastalam nabhisaro grananti.
Nabhastalam nabhisaro grananti.
Urasthalam jyotirani kamasya.
Urasthalam jyotirani kamasya.
Griva maharvadanam vaijanosya.
Griva maharvadanam vaijanosya.
Taporaratim viduradipumsaha.
Taporaratim viduradipumsaha.
Satyam tu shirshani sahasra shirshnaha.
Satyam tu shirshani sahasra shirshnaha.
In these three verses, 14 lokas are described. If you want to know where are 14 lokas described in our culture, in these three verses they are. And if you have Shraddha in the Shastra, remember these 14 worlds are real. They are part of Bhagwan's body. How real is Bhagwan? That real are 14 worlds. As long as you and I have Jiva Bhav, they are existent. If we don't have Jiva Bhav, then they also become non-existent. But till Jiva Bhav is there, they are there. Now you see, where will you go after death? In these 14 places, anywhere. Which will be one part of body of Bhagwan only. So a devotee doesn't have fear. I am going from one part of Bhagwan's body to another part of Bhagwan's body. Why to fear? That doesn't mean do adharma and all that. But the bhava of bhakta is that. So now what does he say? You see. Patalam etasya hi padamulam. So patala is the lowest in the 14 worlds. Patala. So atala, vitala, sutala, rasatala, talatala, mahitala, patal. So what is patal? So he says here that the patal is the sole of the feet. Padamulam. Pathanti parshni prapade rasatalam. And what they say, rasatala is the hinder and the front part of the feet. So sole is the patal, then the top and the back portion of the feet. That, what do you call them? This heel and this front part, that. Rasatalam. Mahatalam Vishvasrijotha Gulfau. So what is the Mahatala? Is the ankles of the Lord. And Talatala is the shanks. Oh, 1 minute. Talatala, the shanks of Virat Purusha. So what are the shanks? This. No, no, this is called the shank. This portion, this is called shank. I don't know what is shin. I did my research on Google to find out shank means what. First I typed shank, some name of some singer came. Then I said, no, no, shank, part of body. So then they said this from below the knee to the ankle. That part is called shank. So that is talatalam vai purushasya janghe. That is that. Then sutala. What is the sutala? The knees of the cosmic being is sutala. And vitala and atala. These are the thighs. Atala. Then we find earth is the loins of the Lord. Now Bhuvarloka is the navel. Suvarloka is the chest. Maharloka is the neck. Janaloka is the face below the brows. Tapoloka is recognized as the brows of the Lord. And Satyaloka as the head. So these are 14 worlds. 7 are above, 7 are below. So above meaning including earth. Bhuhu, Bhuvah, Suvah, Maha, Janaha, Tapah, Satyam. Now this above and below, as far as the Jiva is concerned, how the Jiva goes up and down based on the karma. Punya karma one does, one goes above. Papa karma one does, one goes below. And in Punya karma also, if one does Punya karma with Bhogavritti, then one will go to Suvarloka. From Bhuloka, definitely we will go to Bhuvarloka. That is for sure. After that, where we will go depends on the karma. Bhuvarloka is the intraspace. As soon as the body, this physical body is dropped, the person goes to Bhuvarloka in the Preta Sharir. From Preta Sharir, where the person goes, depends on the karma. Can go up or can go down. So if the Bhoga Vritti is there, then one will go to Swargaloka because that is Bhoga Pradhan. There is Maharloka, Janaloka, Tapaloka and Satyaloka. They are in the ascending order of Vairagya.
After
Swargana. So the most Vairagya who has, maximum Vairagya who has, that person goes to Satyaloka. Who has no desire to come back here, but who for some reason has not realized the truth. So that is the Krama Mukti. Where the Jiva goes to Satyalok is there with Brahmaji there. And the end of the pralay, at the end of the Kalpa, Brahmaji gives knowledge that Jiva gets Mukti. And the Jiva doesn't come back to this earth. He remains in Satyaloka till pralay kal. Because no vasana for bhoga is there, so will not come to any of the worlds down. Will remain there.
Satyaloka and Brahmaloka same.
Satyaloka, Brahmaloka is same. So above is according to the bhoga vasana, punya karma, and according to the tapasya one has done. Below is according to the papa karma. And mixture of papa and punya is when we will be born on the earth. In different yonis. Now you see the permutation and combination. 84 lakh yonis on the earth. Not only on the earth, actually the 84 lakh yonis. It includes all the Devata, Yaksha, Gandharva, all of them. handled 84 lakh yonis into 14 worlds in one Brahmanda. In that combination, on earth, human life alone is capable of speeding up evolution. Because only through that I can reach also Tapolok. Tapolok cannot be reached otherwise. Or Satyalok. So only one. You just see what is the probability. 84 lakh species, 14 worlds. In that one species, one world alone is the possibility of moksha. Conscious moksha. That is a, what is that value of human birth. And with some probability, grace of Bhagwan, some punya we have done, we have landed in that situation. So what to do now? Intensify the efforts and get mukti. Unless you are interested in visiting various lokas and seeing and enjoying and experiencing and then say ki ab sab dekh liya, ab to fir mukti mil jayegi. But if you see this world and if you read the Gita, etc., what do they say? Kshine punya martya lokam vishanti. The pleasures there are also ephemeral. One has to anyway come back to earth. So if I know that this is the only exit, this cannot be forced. One has to feel from within ki bhai, enough is enough now. How much will I see? Same thing in again and again. You know, strange thing is, people do this for philosophy. They don't do that for enjoyment. If you go to a lecture, then they will listen, Gita they will listen, and then Karma Yoga will come in third chapter. Then again, Bhagwan will say similar thing in some sixth chapter also. Again, he will say some similar thing in the 18th chapter. He says, kya bar bar yehi yehi bata rahe hain? But wohi idli khayenge, wohi pizza khayenge, alag 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 roop mein. Us samay koi nahi bolega ki bar bar yehi kyun khila rahe ho? That different packaging they will do and give the same thing. But that time one enjoy, it's a new delicacy. If you go to Swargaloka also, you will get pizza in a different form, but it will be like that raw material only. So if one has understood that, bhai, enough now, how much will I go round and round in this? And when will I get the next birth? That also I don't know. So now better meditate on this. So now this is the main structure, is this 14 worlds. Now comes the rest of the things, hands and all that. So where he says now, what are the hands? That from Indra onwards, downwards, they represent the hands of the Lord. The cardinal points, his ears, and the sound, his auditory sense. Nasatya and Dasra, the twin Ashwini Kumars, they are the nostrils of the Lord. His olfactory sense and flaming fire is the mouth. So Agni is the mouth. The sky constitutes his eyes. The sun, his sense of sight. And day and night form the eyelids of the cosmic being. The abode of Brahma, Satyalok, represents the play of his eyebrows. Water is his palate and taste is his tongue. The Vedas are the crown of his head. Yamaraj is the grinding teeth and the various forms of personal affection are his other teeth. What does that mean? Attachment. Yamaraj will kill, attachment will also kill. You see, what is the word given there? Huh?
For Yamadev is the god of retribution.
Huh. Yama Sneha Kala Dvijani. You see, Sneha Kala. Sneha means that attachment. Sneha word comes from the Snigdha. Snigdha means sticky. Attachment is like that, sticky. And attachment only destroys us. So he says, Yama and all these various forms of attachment, no, they are like the teeth which will destroy. Then Maya, which deludes men, represents his smile. And the unending process of creation. So Bhagwan's smile is also like that. Haso Janma Unmada Kari Chamaya. Ordinary people, when they smile, People fall for it. What a smile. Bhagwan, when he smiles, that smile of Bhagwan is Maya only. It can delude, whole creation can get deluded with that smile of Bhagwan. Haso janmon badakari cha maya. Duranta sargo yada pada yada panga mokshaha. So he says that Maya deludes men, represents his smile and the unending process of creation. His sidelong glances. So many creations are happening just by his side glance. You see. This is interesting analogy. Why? Because with Bhagwan's side glance, many, many creations are happening. With the Guru's side glance, one crosses over Maya. That is called Kataksha Drishti. Kataksha Kirana Chanta Naman Mohabdhaye Namaha. Beautiful line that is. Just the Kataksha Drishti of the Guru, meaning that glimpse of that truth is enough to destroy all the powers of Maya and the whole creation, one goes beyond. Ramakrishna has to touch Vivekananda, that's it. He goes into Samadhi.
What does the word Kataksha mean?
Side glance. Aksha means eyes. Kataksha, side glance, you look like that. Yes. Not even straight.
Because in Hindi they've written here, Anand
Srishti, Usi Maya ka Kataksha Vikshep hai. That's what, Kataksha, na? Kataksha is that, the side glance. But that side glance is not of Maya, it is of the Lord. Bhagwan's Kataksha it is. Yeah. See, in English it is very clear. The Maya which deludes men represents his smile and the unending process of creation, his sidelong glances. It is his glance, not Maya's.
Here you said Vedon ko Bhagwan ka Brahmarandra kehte hain aur yam ko daadhe. Sab prakar ke sneha daant hain aur unki jagan mohini maya ko hi unki muskaan kehte hain. Yah anant srishti usi maya ka kataksh vikshep. So first they said ki unki jagan mohini maya ko hi unki muskaan kehte hain. Then referring to that maya they said
No, that actually that translation is little loose, I think, as far as the Hindi is concerned, because in the English the translation वहाँ पे यम को भगवान की दाढ़ी कैसे बता दिया?
दाढ़
ना? The gums.
No. दाढ़ is
the jaw. हाँ, then it is still okay. I thought दाढ़ी कैसे बता दिया?
Side वाले
दांत
को. हाँ.
Grinders. Right. Yeah, but here in Sanskrit that is, so that one is correct, that is correct. But the Maya, the Kataksha is of Bhagwan only, because here he says this, you know.
Maya is Ishwar's, you know, so that's why they say, which deludes the man because of his smile, the Maya.
See, haso janon mad kari cha maya duranta sargo yadapanga mokshaha. So, it is in Pullinga only. Maya is a Strilinga word. The other adjectives are of Pullinga. So, that Pullinga will refer to Bhagwan only. It will not refer to Maya. So, English translation wise, they have done very correctly. His sidelong glances, that is proper. Then, Yadapanga Moksha. Vridottaro shthodhara eva lobhaha dharma stano adharma pathosya prashtham. Kastasya medhram vrishanav cha mitrav kukshi samudra girayosthi sanghaha. So here he says bashfulness forms his upper lip and greed the lower. Piety constitutes his right breast and the path of unrighteousness his back. This path of unrighteousness is his back means what?
The
back
behind him.
All unrighteous things are done behind the back only. Backstabbing. And that's why we don't show the back to the Lord. That's Dongre Maharaj also wrote that only. That we don't show our back to Bhagwan because of that. You come. Yeah, you come backwards like that. His back. Then Prajapati represents his genitals and the god Mitra and Varuna, the testicles. The ocean forms the cavity of his abdomen and the mountains the system of his bones. See, the mountains are his bones. Rivers constitute his arteries and the veins, and the trees the hair on the person of the cosmic being. The air possessed of this of infinite strength is his breath. Time represents his movement. An uninterrupted action of the three gunas is his activity. The wise recognize the clouds as the hair on the head of the Lord and twilight as the raiment of the infinite being. What is the meaning of raiment?
Clothes.
Clothes. Clothes. Huh. They declare the unmanifest as his heart, and the familiar moon represents his mind. See, moon is the mind of Bhagwan, which is the seat of all passions. They speak of the Mahat Tattva, the cosmic intelligence, as the power of understanding, and Rudra as the ego of the universal spirit. The horse, the mule, the camel and the elephant represent his nails, while the deer and all other animals abide in his hips and loins. The birds are his wonderful workmanship. The first Manu represents his intellect, and man his abode. See that beautiful one. Man is his abode. What does it mean? Man is his abode. Bhagwan is in all. But in Manushya Yoni only you can realize the truth. That is the meaning of that. Man is his abode. That is in the 36th shloka. It is there, you see. Vayam sitadvya karanam vichitram munir manisha manujo nivasaha. Manuja is the Nivasa, human being. Which is why they say, no, the body is a temple, in the temple is God, is the in the heart, Bhagwan is there. So Manujo Nivasaha. Now what does this also mean, that all this is pervaded by Bhagwan? Strange is, some philosophies believe that plants, birds, animals and women don't have Bhagwan.
What?
Yeah, they believe that. Plants, birds, animals and women don't have Bhagwan. Something they are cooked up on their own. Veda to never says anything, and Bhagavata and all of these granthas, they never say anything. But people believe whatever they want to believe. And then they believe some other philosophy, they will believe the size of Atma differs according to the body. Yeah. Ant has smaller Atma, elephant has big Atma. So the more pervasive you are, bigger is your Atma. So don't lose weight. You are a strong Atma.
So then when those jivas have become extinct, the Atmas also died. So dinosaurs became extinct and the Atmas disappeared.
Possible.
That's weird.
That philosophy is all, like those philosophies, if you read, now there are lots of loopholes in that. Once we study Vedanta, then to 20,000 loopholes we will find in so many philosophies which are very, they are not thought through properly at all. See, one can, there are different stages of evolution. At certain stage one believes certain things, but when one starts questioning and inquiring, then one should get proper answers. These different philosophies thrive is because of lack of proper inquiry. One of the reasons. The other reasons also they thrive, but lack of proper inquiry, or so many irrational things they will tell. And the strange thing is, people will find it convincing also. And they will live by it also. Which is why satsang is important, of the right parampara. The importance of parampara people don't realize only. They think, kahin pe bhi jao, kaise bhi padh lo, kuch bhi kar lo, gyan to mil hi gaya. But aray, what type of gyan, what level it is, what does it tell you? So many things have to be understood. Some philosophies will say God is sitting in some world somewhere as one dot of light. And that dot of light will come only in some specific beings and enter them. And whatever they speak is divine voice, and everybody else would listen to that. Now God is not a dot of light sitting somewhere up there. And then the dot of light enters every day, comes up and down. lot of philosophies are there, different philosophies. Not to criticize anybody, but just to be aware that what our scripture says, this is what it is saying, that Bhagwan is all pervasive. When Vedanta says, you know, all the beings are in the Lord and all, and the Lord is in all the beings. Sarva bhutastham atmanam, sarva bhutani chatmani. This is a practical demonstration of that. That all the beings are in Bhagwan. As a Virat Roop or Vishwarup, what Bhagwan showed Arjun. Virat Roop has all the beings in it. So there is nobody excluded. So all these, you know, plants, birds, animals, all of them are included. Then he goes to the celestial beings also. The Gandharvas, they are celestial musicians. The Vidyadharas, demigods. The Charanas, they are the bards and the poets. And the Apsaras, the nymphs, represent the reminiscences of his melody. And the demon hosts, his virility. You see, Asuras are the virility of Bhagwan. So nobody is rejected. In the Virat Roop, everybody is included. That I have to find out. I don't know whether there is a specific reason. Horse, mule, camel, elephant, deer, five. Deer and all the other animals abide in his hips. Yeah.
They all are.
The other are his nails.
These four are his nails.
Then the other things are his
others are his hips and loins. Yeah. I don't know. I don't know. So if there's any specific reason, I'll find out and tell you. No idea if there is any. The Brahmana, now this is where complete chaos. Now when they read this, now they will take this one portion out and they will bash up Hinduism badly. You see, the Brahmana represents the mouth. Brahmananam Kshatrabhujo Mahatma Viduru Rangri Shritakarna Krishna Varnaha Nanabhidha Bhijya Ganopapanno Dravyatmaka Karma Pitana Yogaha. 37th shloka it is. So what does it say here? Brahmana represents the mouth, Kshatriya the arms, Vaishya the thighs, and the dark complexion Shudra, the feet of that mighty being. Finished. These people take this out and say this is all terrible, you know, caste system, this, that. But one very nice explanation I read. When you worship the Lord or you worship anybody, you worship what?
The feet.
The feet, no? So how? And movement happens how? Only through the feet. So how can we say feet are lower? Brahmana is the head because thinking capability is Brahmana. Does the leg have thinking capability? Then where is the question of lower and higher? There is no such psychological discrimination at all. It is just the form of the Lord and one personification which is there, matching certain qualities. That's all it is. But if human being misunderstands this and exploits, that is not the problem of the system. That is the problem of the human being. Nor is it a problem of the culture. Culture is saying beautifully that all are included in this form of the Lord. Each one is divine. But human being wants to control, discriminate, have some power, boss over people. Then that human being goes through. That is the problem of the human being there. So here that's where it is. Brahmana is the mouth, Kshatriya the arms, because Kshatriyas protect. And then Vaishya is the thigh and the Shudra is the feet. And the performance of sacrifices that are conducted with the help of material substances and in the name of classes of deities bearing various names is his occupation. So rites and rituals are the occupation. Such is the magnitude and constitution of the cosmic body of the Lord, as I have just told you. So now this is it. Yan asau Ishvara vigrahasya. Sorry. Yasan nivesha kathito mayate. Sandharyate smin vapushistha vishte. Manasva buddhyana yatosti kankinchita. So he says that it is on this form that the mind is concentrated with the help of reason. For there exists nothing apart from this. So this includes the whole creation. The Virat Roop includes whole creation, not just Thula creation. That's the beauty of the Virat Roop. Virat Roop does not include only this gross earth. What does it include, we saw? 14 worlds. And all the beings of that 14 worlds. Imagine the buddhi of ours, which is so small. If we meditate on the Virat Roop of Bhagwan, what will happen to this buddhi of ours? It expands, no? This is what the bhav does. This is what the upasana will do. Last time I told you, heart becomes expanded. It is not about only quietening the mind. It's about expanding the heart, because in that expansion of the heart, the identity of Mr. So-and-so goes away. When this ocean is meditated upon by the small wave, that this whole ocean, all the waves, foam, bubble, lather, in all the seven oceans which are there, that water is my true nature. Then that small little identity with the wave it has, it will just dissolve. So upasana is method like that. So what is the upasya? In that we must have mahatva buddhi, that the upasya which is there is the form of Bhagwan. Ishwar bhav must come and mahatva buddhi has to come. Both these are important. Then only the expansion happens. In that the dissolution of ego happens. So now he gives an analogy. And just as a dreamer sees himself projected in various forms in a dream, it is all one witnessing self who experiences everything through the intellects of all. One should devote oneself to that embodiment of truth, the storehouse of bliss, and should not feel attached to any other object, for such attachment brings about the degradation of the soul. Such a nice Avyana Advait end me. The dream, how the dreamer projects everything in the dream world, the entire dream world is nothing but that one waker. In the same way, this entire Virat Roop is only one pure consciousness. So one should meditate only on that and not be attached to any other object, because that will bring the degradation. Tam satyam ananda nidhim bhajeta nanyatra sajjed yata atma pataha. This beautiful line, that is last line. Satyam ananda nidhim bhajeta is the abode of truth and bliss. Meditate on that only. Na anyatra sajjet. Don't get attached to anything else. Why? Atma pataha. It will bring downfall only. So last time I told you, Dongre Maharaj said, if you cannot meditate on form of the Lord, at least don't meditate on the samsar. This, all that is from here only. Beautifully how Bhagavat is telling us. So now this is the Virat Roop of Bhagwan. Now if one says, this is very difficult for us to meditate upon. Try doing this now 7 days till the next class. Every day try to meditate. Patal is the feet. Then the rasa, mahatala is the ankles, and then the rasatala is the shanks, and then the other way, whichever. So meditate. Ab wo Sanskrit yaad nahi rahega, to aap ek human form le lo aur likh lo. Patal, rasatal, talatal, mahatal, like that you can make one. And then one meditate. And then try to visualize. This is the form of the Lord, so sentiency comes in that form, vastness comes in that form, bhav comes in that form, and finally it is Advaita, that I am that only. The last conclusion of Shukadevi is Advaita only.
So, when you find what we struggle with actually in class, this using God, almost like using God as a temporary means. Mm-hmm. Where the mind refuses to believe
That it doesn't exist, but we are using it for a means to quietude. Yeah.
It's a means to understand that I am that.
The form,
it's not even a question of form. It's a question of even denying the
existence.
Yeah. There is an entity called God. That there has got to be a creator. And it's just a temporary understanding that I have to have. till I understand who I truly am.
Yeah.
And in that, the little catch is that what we don't understand, I think, is that if that is temporary, then I am also temporary. The one that is understanding, but that one is able to somehow kind of say that, yeah, I know I am temporary. But that is why that belief and that engagement and that anchoring in God, often I think with Advaita studies, with us not understanding it correctly and truly,
is happening.
No, you are two different things you are saying. She is saying something else, you are saying something else. Faith and devotion will come only when existence of God I believe in. No? I don't believe in existence of God only, and I am saying God is a tool. Hari Om. Can you please converse later on? Important things are happening here. Questions are being discussed. So existence of God itself is being questioned.
Yeah.
When we are saying that God does not exist, but it is a tool for us as a means to quieten the mind. It really is not there. It's only to know myself. So much confusion in that or not. Who is this myself? Is that not God?
That's
right. So Advaita, when we study, we actually come to some misunderstanding like this only, that God is only a support system. God is not a support system, Baba. God exists. The form is being used as a support system to quieten the mind. That's all. To connect to that which is already my true self. We should not say God does not exist or the form does not exist. That is a skepticism that comes into the head. Advaita never said it. That's another misunderstanding. Did Advaita ever say that God's form does not exist? From the highest standpoint, it says you, God, creation, all don't exist. But then there is no question of then speaking only then.
Then why have entire scriptures written on the form Correct. Of God and the Leelas?
Yeah, because those are to make people understand this fact only. Advaita also has told or not. Suppose you don't read Bhagavat or anything. What does Advaita say? Does Advaita not say that consciousness, Brahman plus Maya is equal to Ishvara? It is said or not? So even if you don't read the Bhagavat and Ramayana etc., if you have studied Advaita properly, Astitva of Ishvara cannot be denied and Astitva of form also cannot be denied. So misunderstanding of Advaita only can bring all this confusion actually. And the best part I will tell you. Very nice shloka says, Ishvara, Ishvara, Anugrahena, Vina, Advaita Vasana na Bhavati. Without the grace of Ishvara, the Vasana for Advaita also will not be there. And this Advaita only is being used to deny the existence of that Ishvara. You see, that is all the skepticism of the Buddhi. That Buddhi wants to just negate all the forms, all the support systems, all the associations with God itself. Is that not a form of atheism in some way? Studying Advaita and thinking God is only a support system, God really does not exist, it's only a means to quieten the mind, it is one form of atheism only.
That's when the degradation of soul happens.
Then one will get attached to objects and all, then the degradation of the soul will happen. But for us as sadhaks, what is important to understand is that, do I have this misunderstanding? Because our misunderstanding should not be there, you know, I am Advaitin and God's form really does not exist and then it's just a means. So I don't even feel like connecting. I don't have the bhav. And then I want to meditate and my mind is going to wander, but I still don't know.
That's the whole goal of Bhagavatam.
So that's the doubt, sanshaya is there. No? Then the sanshaya is there.
Everything is there with that. Sanshaya is there. Nastikta is there. And I may still say Advaita and I will still say I am Brahman, I am Brahman, I am Brahman. But which Brahman are you? If you are negating Ishvara, negating Hiranyagarbha, negating Virat, negating all the other forms of Bhagavan. Your form is real and Brahman is real. In between there is nothing. That's confusion only. If one says I studied Advaita and I don't believe in God and believe in forms, I am an Advaitin. Vyasa Maharshi is sitting here in the Bhagavad Katha of Shukdev Ji. After realizing and after teaching Bhagavat, which he himself wrote, he is sitting in the Katha of Sukhdevji to listen to glory of Bhagavan. Now what are you and I? So humility has to come. If Advait study does not bring humility and surrender to Ishvara, then what Advait we are studying? Advait is only to destroy our Jiva Bhav. It is not to destroy Ishvara Bhav. Ulta hi ho gaya. Advait pad pad ke Ishvara ko nasht kar diya, Jiva Bhav ko badha diya. Such a tragedy, na it is. Advait should destroy my Jiva Bhav. But we can use Advait. That's the buddhi, perverted buddhi it is, how it will destroy. And every seeker goes through that at some phase in life till the clarity of Advait doesn't come. Suddenly one says, "Mai puja paath nahi karta, mai to Advaitin hu." You don't want to do puja paath, it's okay. Japa karo, upasana karo, bhajan gao.
Stay connected.
Yeah. You know, I'll tell you one, when I'll end. When we went to join Vedanta course, no, one brahmachari came. So initial days, you see, that's called the testing period. Wickets will fall, tap, tap, tap. How many will sustain that, we don't know. So one brahmachari had come from Bhakti Marg, okay. And every evening we will have satsang in the temple. Aarti will happen, then satsang will be there, 7 to 8. In which we sing some bhajans for some time. And then some stotram we will learn. And then some part will be some satsang on a particular topic. So initial few days, so we are still learning some bhajans. Those who know bhajans, they will sing and all that. So this one brahmachari who had come, he told, he saw a few days. He stayed for some 7-10 days or something. He was there in the course. Then he left. You know why he left? He told us all, you people have no bhakti at all. What you are singing, not one fellow is crying. Aap log ke aankh mein se aansu hi nahi aa raha hai. If tears don't come, what kind of bhakti you are doing? That tears are required. Bhav is required. You are all dry intellectuals. Main ja raha hu chhod ke. Aise nastikon ke company mein main nahi reh sakta hu. Wo chala gaya. He was very convinced about his this thing that, you know, bhav has to be there. If bhav is not there, I will not stay here. So sometimes I think about that person and I feel in some way he was right also. Because if Advait pad pad ke agar hard hearted ban gaye hain aur koi bhav hi nahi hai, to kya Advait pad rahe? I'm not saying we were hard hearted at that point, but he concluded that ki ye to dry intellectualism hai. Because he had come from that tradition where, you know, just listening to Bhagavan's name, horripilation should come. And if you see him, he is like that. You tell Krishna, you will see literally horripilation on his body. Just the word Krishna you have to say. And he will sing, he will go into one, as though he is in some trance. You know, very nice. But that is all comes by punya also. Bhav comes with that. So bhavana and Jnan, they should go together. Bhagavat is the best book for getting both these together. Advait and Bhav, both will come. Naraji told him to write. Not feeling fulfilled, yeah. No, he had Bhav, but he was not feeling fulfilled. Yeah. See, sometimes those are also leelas. It is not possible for somebody to write and compile entire Veda plus the Brahma Sutra and all that without having bhav at all. That's just for us. That if you want fulfillment in life, you must include bhakti. That's all it is to teach us. Otherwise, he is Bhagavan Vishnu's roop only. Why will he not have bhav?